Let's start the presentation. This talk would be about various issues in design and analysis of high-speed optical links. That is, we are talking about 40 Gbps and beyond. So, basically, first of all, let us see why there is a continued requirement of very high data bitrate and what are the various issues actually involved in this design. It is very important to understand those issues if you want to be a successful designer or successful engineer in this field. So we'll be discussing in the first few slides in detail that what are the issues involved, and then on the later slides I will discuss some more advanced issues and also some tips for designing of high speed, high data rate optical links. So as you all know that now we are going to era in which everywhere there is IoT and smart cities and very high speed internet. So there have been very rapid advances in optical technologies and techniques for high speed fiber transmission last few days, for a few years, sorry. And basically in today's scenario, whether your last mile is Wi-Fi or RF, but we cannot imagine this scenario without the backbone optical fiber communication links. So these links are very important. And nowadays we are seeing record breaking every few years as far as the capacity and distance product is concerned. This is a very important parameter of any high speed optical link, that is the bandwidth into distance. And we are moving towards very highly flexible and transparent optical networks. Flexible means you can do all the switching and routing and then add more number of users whenever required. Your bandwidth has become dynamic. And transparent means that there are actually no such conversions required which were earlier there, because now you have optical amplifiers, EDFAs, which are inline amplifiers and fully transparent. So modern optical networks are now primarily based on 10 Gbps and 40 Gbps. And also, I mean, if you talk of long haul networks, it's very common to talk in terms of terabits per second nowadays. So these are the speeds which we are talking about nowadays. And in addition to the increase in data rate per channel, the number of channels per fiber has also increased by a large, huge factor, particularly after this wavelength division multiplexing or DWDM came into existence a couple of decades ago. So potentially, I mean, these technologies are very important, WDM and DWDM, because they can improve the overall capacity and I mean, they can save on the expenditure. You can save on capital expenditure because you don't need to lay new fibers there. You can use WDM or multiplexing to carry multiple channels over the same fiber, and same transmitter receiver cost is shared. So that is the important point about these high data rate links. So let us try to understand what are the key issues in high data rate link design. Now, these issues, you will realize that it is very important for you to understand these issues, and you will also see that how these various issues are interlinked to each other. I mean, you cannot work in isolation on one factor and the other factor will not be affected. I mean, if you work on one thing, then the other thing is affected, and the second thing is affected, then third thing is affected, third factor is affecting the first one. So they are all interlinked. So we will see what are the key issues involved in high data rate link design, optical link design. So as you go for higher and higher data bit rates in excess of Gbps, say 40 or 100 Gbps, you will invariably require multiplexing. Okay, now multiplexing is, as I told you earlier also, and you might be knowing, it can be TDM or WDM or SDM, space division multiplexing. Of course, TDM was the most common and the most, you can say, earlier multiplexing technique used in optical fiber communication. Ultimately, what is the problem with this time division multiplexing? Why we have to move necessarily to WDM? Because TDM has a limit, since too high bit rate is limited by the supporting electronics. So what happens in a time division multiplexing? You have the pulses divided as far as the time is concerned. You assign a time slot to different pulses or different channels. So these this is the pulse spacing, and that actually decides the data rate or bit rate. So this you can increase the bit rate indefinitely by making this more thin and then also reducing the bit spacing, I mean the distance between the two bits. But ultimately that puts a limit, because optically it may be possible to further reduce this spacing and further reduce this the thickness or the, you can say, width of the pulse and the time period. But ultimately you see, you have the transmitter on one side and receiver on one side, and then optical fiber in between. So this fiber is actually capable of handling even higher bit rates. But the problem is that when you have some electronics, you will need to convert this very high data bit rate into electrical signal ultimately, and then here also electrical signal is converted to optical. So this is actually mainly done by the electronics. There is no other option. So this electronics is actually not coping up very well, although there are developments taking place in CMOS technology, and you are going further and further in down and down in nanometers fabrication. But still, these electronics, it is not able to cope up with such a high data rate. So that's why this TDM has actually ultimately hit the limit. Again, okay, there was some noise. So that I was telling, the TDM has ultimately hit a limit. So basically you have to necessarily move to WDM, wavelength division multiplexing, because there what you can do, you can divide this fiber into different wavelengths rather than time slots, and then these wavelengths lambda 1, lambda 2, up to lambda n, they can be transmitted together in the same time, but ultimately they will be received by different receivers. So your the requirement of receiver are greatly relaxed. The receiver doesn't have to decode very high data bit rate, because it has been divided by channel separation or using wavelengths, different wavelengths. Second very important issue is the dispersion effects also come into play at higher bit rates. So as you increase this bit rate more and more, the dispersion actually starts to affect, and particularly in long distance communication, let's say 100 kilometers and 40 Gbps, then these issues are very, very important. So we'll discuss somewhat more details later on. Another very important thing, very important issue is the amplification. Because these long haul networks, as I said, they go many, many kilometers, hundreds of kilometers from one place to other place. And they also have some finite attenuation, which is 0.2 dB per kilometer, the state of the art. So naturally, if it is going 100 kilometers, it will be reduce in amplitude, and therefore you will need amplifiers in between. But amplifiers, they also have very rigid requirement here in optical domain. First of all, because they need to be wideband. Why wideband? Because now you are transmitting the data in the form of WDM. You have from lambda 1 up to lambda n number of wavelengths, and it spans a long spectrum, wide spectrum. So if you are passing these through an amplifier, you have to ensure that this amplifier is actually able to handle such a wide bandwidth, and it is do able to do justice with all the wavelengths, that it is amplifying all those with equal gain. So its gain spectrum is also very important. Gain of EDFA or whatever amplifier you are using, it is very important. That's why I say it should be flat gain. And then it should be transparent also. Transparent means that it should not require any, first of all, optical has to be converted to electrical, and then again it's converted to optical like this. It should not be able to do this. It should not require this. It should directly convert optical to optical without any electrical. So the EDFAs are one such amplifiers, which I mean, maybe we'll see in some more detail later on. Optical amplifiers such as EDFAs provide excellent inline amplification, and they are transparent also. They have wideband also. But the problem is that whatever amplifier you use, I hope you know from your RF knowledge also and optical knowledge also, that any amplifier which you place in between, it will always have some effect on the signal to noise ratio. So the optical signal to noise ratio you have to take care, because in long haul communication systems with high data bit rate, 40 Gbps, your SNR and bandwidth, these two are the most important parameters. So SNR actually is degraded by optical amplifiers. Any amplifier, it will degrade SNR to a certain extent. Again, we'll see later on in the later slide some more details about this. Okay, now then again, if we discuss that, as I said on the previous slide, the amplifiers, they somewhat affect your signal to noise ratio somewhere. And also, amplifiers are not easy to install. I mean, they always have some technology or technique is required to install the amplifiers in between. So what is the best remedy? It looks like that you can increase the input power. You can increase so that whatever attenuation is there along the link length from TX to RX. So if you increase the power of transmitted, then it looks like that you may overcome the requirement of amplifier. It may not be needed because now you are initially transmitting more power. But the problem occurs because the fiber nonlinearity also comes into picture when you have high powers in I mean transmitted through the optical fiber. So fiber nonlinear effects, they are very, very important in your high speed data rate systems, long haul systems, and it can dramatically degrade the transmission performance when signal power exceeds a certain threshold. So again, we'll see briefly later on what different nonlinear effects you have, actually how they degrade the performance. There are many types of nonlinear effects. You have self phase modulation, you call it as SPM, that is self phase modulation. You have cross phase modulation. You have four wave mixing, FWM. You have Raman effect, Raman scattering. So all these are very important, you can say, nonlinear effects. Although optical fiber is a dielectric, it is made of silica. So this nonlinearity is not that significant. I mean, as far as the magnitude is concerned, it looks like it is a small nonlinearity because silica has a very small nonlinear coefficient. But still, when you all these things become important when you talk about your high speed and long distance communications. Anything more than 40 Gbps or 1 Tbps, even these small effects, they become very significant. So higher bitrate transmission require larger optical signal to noise ratio. And how do you define signal to noise ratio? It is a signal power and the ratio of the noise power. Noise power we'll see later on. It is mainly ASE noise, that is amplified spontaneous emission noise. It is very significant. And so the signal to noise ratio depends on this. Another aspect of the key issue in high data rate link design is that you can use advanced optical modulation formats. There are a number of advanced optical modulation formats which are being used and being researched nowadays. They can, by proper choice or by proper selection of particular advanced optical modulation format, you can have multi-level formats or QPSK or QAM. They can significantly lower the required system OSNR. Okay. Lower the required system OSNR, it means they have better signal to noise, they can maintain better signal to noise ratio. So these are some of the key issues which I have mentioned: amplification, nonlinearity, dispersion, attenuation, all these factors are there. Now, what are the key design issues? Suppose you are a designer and you are trying to design a long optical fiber link with high data rate. So there will be certain issues which you have to think of as an engineer or as a designer. So you have so many parameters here, so many things which you need to think. And also, as I said, one selection actually affects the other one. It's not that they are all independent. If you choose one, you find it better in one situation, it may not be better in other situation, or it may degrade some other things. There are trade-offs actually in this. So selection of appropriate fiber is very important, whether you should have a multi-mode or a single mode fiber, or you need to have a dispersion shifted fiber or something like that. Again, I'll discuss that in detail. Selection of appropriate wavelength band is very, very important. What wavelength you want to use? You cannot choose any wavelength at your will, because you know silica fiber has certain characteristics and you need to choose those wavelengths accordingly, and depending on the distance also, whatever distance of the link, whether it is 10 kilometer or whether it is 100 kilometers, it makes a lot of difference. I mean, that wavelength you have to choose accordingly. That again I will discuss later on. Selection of appropriate devices, including amplifiers. Now that is again very important. Devices means it includes amplifier, it includes your sources, whether you want to have LED, whether you want to have a laser. Say if you have a very short distance communication link, let's say if you are working within a building and let's say it is around 1 kilometer or that range, then LED can be a choice of source, because LED is cheaper and it is easier to launch power from an LED into an optical fiber. The coupling is easier. Whereas if you are thinking of a link with the 10 kilometers length and 40 Gbps speed, then naturally you need to choose a laser, which is more expensive, more difficult to maintain, because it requires proper temperature monitoring and maintenance of temperature, because otherwise its parameters will change. So you need a proper, you can say, selection of a source. Similarly, the dispersion will depend on this LED or laser, and also the selection of fiber, it will also depend on this, because if it is a multi-mode fiber you have chosen, then LED can work. But if it is a single mode fiber that you have chosen, depending on your distance, how much distance you want, then only laser can be a good choice for this. Amplifiers I have already discussed, I will discuss more. Then you need to do a link design analysis. Link design means that once you have chosen your transmitter, what device you need, you have chosen your receiver, and then you have chosen what type of fiber is there, then there are amplifiers in between, there are splices in between. So you need to do a proper link design or link analysis, which tells you that if you have so much of output power from here, and this is the receiver sensitivity, Receiver sensitivity is the minimum received power it needs to have, because what receiver does, the optical power is falling on this and it is converting it to electrical power, this receiver. It's a photodiode, photo detector. So this optical power which is falling on this, it has a certain minimum requirement that this receiver is, it's called the sensitivity, that it should have minimum this much of power, let us say 0.5 milliwatt or whatever. So that power should be incident on this so that it can successfully convert this into electrical. If it is less than that, it will not be able to detect it and this power will be lost or it will give rise to errors. So this link design actually is done in such a way that how much power is required at the transmitter, how much is the receiver sensitivity, what are the various losses. So all these things you have to consider in that link design. Again, I will discuss slightly more details later on. Dispersion management is very, very important in any optical link, which is high speed and long length. Dispersion, as you know, again, I will tell you that it is basically broadening of the pulse. So you have a number of design challenges, design issues here. You have dispersion shifted fibers, you have non-zero dispersion shifted fibers. I will discuss briefly later on. Nonlinear effects in multi-channel systems, I have already told you. Why I say multi-channel? Because these nonlinear effects, as I said, they become important when you have high power. And this high power is achieved in multi-channel because you have, let us say, 256 channels in a DWDM system, okay? And multiplex, you are multiplexing these 256 channels, lambda. So each channel must be having some minimum power. So you have a huge increase in the power, total power. So that affects your performance of the fiber and it becomes, it starts to behave in a nonlinear fashion. So that is also again very important. Modulation formats, I already mentioned, you have to choose accordingly that which modulation format provides you lesser bandwidth or which provides you suppressed carrier, or all those things are involved in that. So these are the key design issues which are involved in that. So now coming on to the design aspects of point-to-point links, I am not considering optical networks directly here because you have already, that's a different topic actually. But here I am considering point-to-point links, but whatever I am discussing, whatever the fundamentals I am discussing here, they equally apply all to all optical networks also. So yeah. So as you know, this is you have the source of light here, the source, information source. Then you convert this electrical signal to optical, and then you have the channel, optical fiber, and then at the receiver, the reverse process is taking place. It is converting this optical signal back to detecting and then converting to electrical. So the design of an optical link involves many interrelated variables such as fiber, source, photo detector, operating characteristics, amplifiers, and so on. So, and you may require several iterations before you are satisfied that your design is working properly. So all these things we'll see in this. Okay, now when you start designing your optical fiber link, there are three most important criteria or requirements which you might like to know before starting a design. First is that how much is your possible transmission distance? That is very important, because if you are designing for 1 kilometer length, your design criteria will be totally different. If you are designing it for 100 kilometer length, you will have totally different design. All selection of parameters, all selection of materials, devices, it will depend on what is the desired length of transmission. Second thing is data rate or channel bandwidth. This is again very, very important, because let's say we are designing it for 40 Gbps, then you have to take care of lot many parameters because it's a high data rate system. Okay. So you had to think of that also. And just let me move this window slightly. Yeah. So data rate or channel bandwidth is very important. The third is bit error rate. That is again very important because let us say you have a bit error rate of a target bit error rate of 10 to the power minus 9. Now this is I think it's a quite good data bit error rate in case of optical communication. What it means is that if you transmit 10 to the power 9 bits, then there is a probability of error in one of the bits. So that is called a bit error rate of 10 to the power minus 9. So all these things which you are designing, they are dependent on what bit error rate you have in mind or in target. If I violate any of these design parameters, let us say my designed distance is, let us say, L is equal to 100 kilometers, and I just push it and use it for, let us say, L is equal to 150 kilometers. I mean, it doesn't mean that it will not work. It will still work, but you will be having a much poorer bit error rate. Maybe you will have 10 to the power minus 8 or 10 to the power minus 7. So that is the thing here. Similarly, if you keep it 100 kilometers only, but if you change from 40 GBPS to, let us say, I change it to 300 or 400 GBPS, then again, it doesn't mean that your system will not work. It will keep on working, but again, you will have to sacrifice some bit error rate and your quality of transmission will again decrease. It will be affected. So let us see what choices we have in these various factors which I mentioned to you. So as a designer, it's you have a see when I say as a designer, you have a lot of choices. You may think that it is a very good thing that you have a lot of choices and you can choose anything. But at the same time, it becomes complex also because sometimes, when you have more choices, then it's very difficult to select which one is the best and how to identify which one is working, which is not working. So the designer has a choice of following components and their associated characteristics. As far as fiber is concerned, this is for fiber. This is your source, and this is your receiver or photodetector. So for fiber, you can have multi-mode or single-mode optical fiber. First of all, that is the most important because, as I said, if you want to go longer distance in hundreds of kilometers, only single-mode optical fiber is the choice. But in smaller distances within a building, or if you are working in a laboratory, then you can use multi-mode fiber. Now, if you, I mean, once you want to decide the whether multi-mode, single mode, these factors are also important. The core size of the optical fiber is important because single-mode fiber will have a smaller core size, multi-mode fiber will have a higher core size. The core refractive index profile is very, very important. Refractive index profile means normally you have a step index fiber. So if you have the core and if you have the cladding, then the refractive index is something like this. I mean, it is some value, and then cladding has a slightly lower refractive index. So there is a step change here. At this boundary, there is a step change, sudden change in the refractive index. Here it is high and here it is low. So you do not have just a step index profile. I will show you in later in one of the slides that you have very complex refractive index profiles possible, and you choose that according to your requirement. Bandwidth or dispersion is very important. How much dispersion the fiber is causing. Again, it all depends on whether it is multimode or single mode. Attenuation is the most important, the very basic criteria, because you do not want to choose any wavelength or anything. You just want to use a smaller attenuation, because if you choose less attenuation window, less number of amplifiers are required, as I mentioned earlier also. Numerical aperture, it is again related to your core size and refractive index, both field diameter. When you come to the source, you need to choose LED or laser diode. Emission wavelength is important, at what wavelength you want to work. Spectral line width, what is the spectral line width? I will show on the next slide. What is the output power? Because laser can have more power, but LEDs are not so powerful. What is the effective radiating area? It is very important that, because let us say you have a LED and it is radiating in all directions and the area is very large, and if you try to couple it to a single mode fiber, SMF, single mode fiber is having a diameter of 9 micrometer. Most of the power from this will not be coupled properly to this single mode fiber. So effective radiating area is also very important, because as I told you, all parameters are interdependent. This depends on, again, this fiber. Emission pattern, it is also very important, that how it is emitting in a conical fashion or it is ellipsoid radiation pattern. Number of emitting modes is very important. If you want to have excite a single mode only, then you need to limit the number of modes. You do not want more modes. Similarly, the receiver is, again, choice of receiver is very important. Depends again on your bit rate and your distance. Responsivity, that is the quantum efficiency, operating wavelength, speed, sensitivity, all these are very, very important. Speed is, of course, as I mentioned, because you are working in terabits per second, and then if you find that your receiver, the photo detector, it is only working at megabits, or it is not able to work at gigabits, so again you have a problem. Whole of your exercise is lost. Whole of the advantage of optical fibers is lost if your supporting electronics is not able to cope up with the other things. Sensitivity, as I already mentioned in previous lecture also, it is very important. Quantum efficiency is that efficiency means how much light is falling on it, and out of it how much electricity or how much current it is generating. That is the quantum efficiency. So till now I have given you an overview of why this high data bitrate system is required. In the very first slide I mentioned that because you need that more data for 5G and for smart cities, and 6G now we are talking, you need a very high, tremendous amount of data. So that is the requirement. Then I mentioned that what are the issues, what are the various factors, the non-linearity, dispersion, how many parameters are available to you to choose from. So these are the choice of material. So I will maybe skip this part, because I will anyway discuss it later in detail. It's actually the same description, that how the wavelength of operation is, that I will discuss when I go to the figure that next time. This is, you can see the spectral width and line width of a laser and an LED. The spectral width of an LED is much higher than the spectral width of a laser. This laser has a spectral width, a very short spectral width. So it is better when you consider the dispersion in the system. And sometimes this laser output is something like this, that you have this many small, you can say, lines in this. These are all lines which are available. So even the very good lasers, they may have this type of characteristics. So ultimately you want this one only. So you may need to apply some special filters here to select one of these, or maybe you can have some advanced laser format, laser this structures like DBR laser, you might have heard, DFB laser. cleaved coupled cavity lasers. All these lasers are different types of lasers. That is distributed Bragg reflector. This is distributed feedback reflector, and cleaved coupled cavity lasers. All these are actually different methods by which you can further refine the output characteristics of laser by choosing only one mode. So usually, I mean, lasers are said to be monochromatic, but in reality, no laser is monochromatic. It has a very small line width, but it is a finite. It's not a zero line width, so it is some spectrum. Of course, it is better than LED, much much better. And the wavelength stability is also very important. And why it is important here in optical? Because as I told you, you have, let us say, in this system. Let me show a block diagram here. It's an optical fiber communication block diagram. You have 256 channels. Let us say 256 lambdas, lambda 1 and lambda n up to lambda n, and they are all propagating. Now assume what happens when, let us say, I have a laser here for each wavelength: laser 1, laser 2, laser 3, laser 4, laser 5, and laser n. Each laser is generating a wavelength of lambda 1, lambda 2. So actually, if you see the spectrum of all these signals, they are very very closely spaced to each other. If I say frequency and amplitude, one wavelength is here, other wavelength is here, other wavelength is here. So this is a very small 4 nanometer spacing between these in ultra wide WDM, wavelength division multiplexing. So imagine what will happen if the frequency generated by these lasers are not stable. I mean, this is generating a wavelength here or a frequency. Now, if it is not stable with time or with temperature, it may interfere with this because it is a very closely spaced channel. Similarly, if this is not stable, this may interfere with this. So there can be a lot of interference, and your whole WDM system may collapse if you are not controlling this properly. So, normally in a point-to-point link, a small instability doesn't really matter, but it is very very important in WDM. And why I say WDM? Because whenever you say 40 Gbps, you invariably always use your WDM technology in that, because a single channel cannot possibly have 40 Gbps. Even if it has, you have to have supporting electronics, very fast electronics, which can be able to handle, which can handle that very high data bit rate. Photo detector, as I have already mentioned, again you have two choices: you have pin photodiode or avalanche photodiode, APD. So pin photodiode is somewhat cheaper and better, but avalanche photodiode has more sensitivity. It has some internal gain built in. So again, depends on how you make a compromise between the cost, performance. That as a designer, you have to choose that what is your requirement, whether you want to spend more money to buy more quality, or you do not want to spend too much money and you are okay with somewhat lower quality. So yeah, this I have already just now discussed. These are the design consideration for a fiber. Single mode or multi mode, you already know that. These are the single mode and multi mode core diameters. So normally you have core diameter of 9 micrometer for a single mode. It can be 50 or 62.5 for a multi mode fiber. And you see that this diameter is very very small, as in this case. This core diameter is very small, and if you launch an LED, use an LED here, it will not be able to couple most of the power because of its radiation pattern and because of its multiple modes. Whereas if you have a laser here, it will be, that is the only choice for a single mode fiber. For multi-mode, you can have LED or any other, but again, if you are going for a long distance, very long distance, 10 kilometers or more, then these different modes actually will cause a problem, and then If you have input pulse like this, your output pulse will be distorted like this because of the multipath or other dispersion. So that you have to make a choice. Now I will quickly move on to the next thing in fiber selection. How do you select fiber and how do you select a wavelength based on attenuation characteristics? You all know that this is the attenuation characteristics. I am not going into details of this. But just one thing I want to mention here, that this is the attenuation characteristics of silica fiber, SiO2, which is the most commonly used with respect to wavelength. This is a very important part here, Rayleigh scattering. There are some UV tails and infrared absorption tails. And then there are some OH peaks here, these green curves you can see. So they all contribute to the attenuation or absorption of light. So resultant graph is this red one that you get, this one, and this is the resultant graph of all these. So if I go to the next slide, you see here, these are all the operating bands here, O band, E band, S band, C band, L band. So if you look closely, this C band, actually it has the lowest attenuation. You can also see this is the first window, second window and third window, and this is the OH peak in the attenuation, this water peak. So because of this water peak, actually you do not want to use this E band. Normally it is avoided, E band, in long distance optical communication. So you always use this third window, which is the C band, and which is 50 nanometers, micrometers, 1.55 micrometers. This is in nanometers. So I mean, your choice of wavelength, it all depends on this. You cannot choose this wavelength. Sometimes people earlier used this first window. Earlier it was used because that time this technology was not matured, so they used this 850 nanometer. Then second window was also used, 1310, or sometimes it is also called 1300 in some books, nanometer. Now this has a very important, very interesting story behind this, which I will discuss later. I mean, when I discuss the dispersion part, then I will discuss this again. It has very important characteristics. And then this, of course, third window is there, which is having the lowest attenuation. Now coming on to the dispersion, which is, as I said, it is very, very important part of any high data rate optical link. So you see, this is the effect of chromatic dispersion. Dispersion again is of many, many different types, but most importantly, this is the chromatic dispersion. So you see, what is the effect of chromatic dispersion? If I say this is a long link length and very high data bit rate, so a pulse, if you transmit through this optical fiber, even if it is a single mode fiber, there was some noise. So even if this is a single mode fiber, then that, okay, that multipath dispersion may not be there, but chromatic dispersion will always be there. So because of this dispersion, basically what is dispersion? Dispersion means that this, you see this pulse, if you see the spectrum of this pulse, this is in time domain, and the spectrum, if you see, it has a broad spectrum, maybe a sync pulse or something like that. So this has a lot of wavelength components here. So when these all this pulse in, consisting of all these wavelength components, when it travels through this optical fiber, because of this chromatic dispersion, each part of this pulse actually travels at a different speed. So ultimately, when it this pulse reaches at the receiver, it reaches at different times because different parts of it have traveled at different speeds. So it will be broadened like this. So you can see there is a broadening of the pulse. And what is the effect of this broadening? Say if you have a high data rate system with the bits very closely spaced to each other, then they will start to overlap. And this is what happens. I mean, here, even after no dispersion or maybe some small dispersion, you can, your receiver, when it goes to the receiver here, RX receiver, when it tries to detect, because when the receiver, let us say it is a intensity modulation direct detection type receiver, which senses whether the light is one or zero. So if this is the case, then it can easily say that this is one, this is zero, and this is one. But if you allow more dispersion or more length of the fiber, then ultimately this starts to happen. And if further you allow more dispersion, then you will have overlapping. So you can see that there is error here by the receiver, and it may give rise to higher bit error. So that is the material dispersion coefficient. It is basically, it is coming because your n, the refractive index, normally we say the refractive index of core is 1.5. Very basically we say, whenever we start study of this optical fibers, we say refractive index is 1.5, but this is only half truth. Full truth is that n actually is a function of wavelength, or n is a function of frequency. So n is not constant at all wavelengths. It depends on the wavelength. So that's why this d2n by d lambda square, second derivative of this, is important. If n is not dependent on wavelength, if it doesn't depend on wavelength, then d2n by d lambda, you can say dn by d lambda will be zero. But if it is not so, which is usually the case, you will have some dispersion parameter, and this is the pulse broadening because of this dispersion. You can see it depends on the length, it depends on the spectral width of the source, this one, spectral width. And also it depends on how your refractive index changes with the wavelength. So all these three parameters are very, very important. There may be other dispersions also. You have polarization mode dispersion. That is, you can split your signal into two perpendicular polarizations. One is horizontal, one is vertical. And when this propagates, because I mean, the fibers are not ideal, they may have some asymmetries also at the time of fabrication, or because of some pressure applied, uneven pressure applied. So what may happen, that one polarization may travel faster than the other, and ultimately at the receiver, your pulse, if it, the pulse was something like this, it will be distorted like this. So that is polarization mode dispersion. You call it as PMD in short. Okay, now coming on to the very important discussion on waveguide, this, all this dispersion. Now, this is very important for you to understand. See what happens here. This is dispersion on this side. This is wavelength on this side. This is zero dispersion here on this side. So if you see this dotted curve here for material dispersion, this is the dispersion graph for a silica fiber, silica material. So dispersion is very high here. Dispersion is also very high here. Remember, it is only the magnitude we are talking about, the modulus of dispersion. We cannot say that if dispersion is negative, it means it is a good one, or it is positive, it is good. Whether it is positive, whether it is negative, it is bad for your fiber. Only the magnitude that is important. So here also the dispersion is high. It is negative high, but it is high. Here also it is high. But at this point, this is very important point here. At this point, your material dispersion crosses the zero point here. So from here, it crosses this, and it is zero. So for silica fibers, I again remind you, it is for silica. There is a wavelength of 1.276 micrometers. You can read from here approximately, where there is a zero material dispersion. If you also include the waveguide dispersion, this graph, now again, very important thing, let me tell you, this material dispersion, it only depends on your material, what type of material you have. If you have chosen silica, then it will be having this much dispersion, you cannot change it. Whereas this waveguide dispersion, it is very important to understand that this waveguide dispersion does not depend on directly on material, but it depends on the shape of your optical fiber, optical waveguide. That what is the core refractive index profile, what is the step change here, what is the cladding refractive index. So that all depends on your this shape of the waveguide. So any waveguide, any optical fiber having this material dispersion, this waveguide dispersion, if you combine these two, if you take the sum of these two, this is your resultant dispersion, which is chromatic dispersion, which is sum of this material dispersion and sum of this. So you see now that combining this and this, your zero dispersion wavelength has shifted from 1.276 to some other value. Okay, let us say 1.5. Not always, but let us say in this case, it has shifted to 1.50 micrometer. Now, this should give you immediately, it should click to your mind, because I said that you cannot control this as long as you have silica here, but you can control this because it depends on the design of your fiber, how you have designed it. So you can actually change the zero dispersion wavelength as per your design. Say if I choose a different different waveguide here with different waveguide dispersion, let me say I choose this one instead of this, then my resultant curve would be something like this. So I have a different zero dispersion wavelength. So basically what I want to say is that you can choose or you can design your waveguide in such a way that you can have, you can shift the zero dispersion wavelength from here to a point of your choice. Of course, there are limitations. You cannot do whatever you like. Within a short range, you can do this. Now, what is the importance of this? Why it is important to shift the material, shift the zero dispersion point? Because you know that if you want to operate here, or maybe if you want to operate here, okay, ideally you can operate here and you have zero dispersion here, lambda zero dispersion, but your attenuation is not minimum here. In the previous slide, I told you the attenuation is minimum at 1.55 micrometer. So now you have, as a designer, you have a dilemma whether to use this wavelength or whether to use 1.55 where attenuation is minimum. So attenuation also you cannot change. You cannot change attenuation wavelength here or here because it again depends on the properties of silica. You cannot change it. So the solution is that you design your waveguide in such a way that you now you have, you can shift your zero dispersion point to a point where you have zero minimum attenuation also. So let me go to the next slide. Yeah, this one. This shows you dispersion and attenuation together. This one is the attenuation, and this is dispersion normal fiber, which is, I call it dispersion unshifted fiber. So basically, by choosing or by designing your fiber properly, you can have dispersion shifted fibers. So these are dispersion shifted fibers. This is dispersion shifted fiber. So you can overlap this zero dispersion wavelength by dispersion shifting with the minimum dispersion wavelength. So now both are at the same point. And as a designer, one of your greatest headaches is gone, that if you can have a wavelength where you have zero dispersion and minimum attenuation also, then that is a good thing. So that you can do by using this. So you have dispersion shifted fibers. You also have dispersion flattened fibers. You call this as DFF. Now, what is dispersion flattened fiber? You see this purple curve here. You design your waveguide dispersion in such a way that you have a long wavelength range where your dispersion is almost zero. Not exactly zero, but very small value dispersion. It is a very small value and over a long wavelength range, broad range. So that is dispersion flattened fiber, that is DFF. And then there is a concept of non-zero dispersion shifted fiber. I will discuss that later because that should sound interesting to you, because when I say dispersion shifted fiber, I want a zero dispersion here. But then again, I start talking of a non-zero dispersion shifted. Deliberately, I choose a value which is having small dispersion, not zero dispersion, because that will affect your nonlinear effects that I will discuss later on. So as I mentioned, that by choosing different refractive index profiles, you can choose your waveguide dispersion. There are not many things. How do you do the dispersion compensation in very high data bitrate systems, 40 Gbps or more, and let us say 100 kilometers? So this is a very interesting concept here, that let us say you have a transmitter, you have a input pulse here, and long transmission fiber with high data bitrate. Then obviously, if you are launching this pulse, it will disperse. It is shown by different colors at different locations. It means it has spread. Different wavelengths are traveling at different speed. Now, what you do is, whatever dispersion it has taken place, let us say lambda 1 is traveling faster. Lambda 1 is traveling faster, and lambda n here on the other side, lambda n is traveling slower. So that has given rise to a dispersion of the pulse broadening. So in that case, what you can do, you can put a short length of dispersion compensating fiber. Dispersion compensating fiber, that fiber is actually designed in such a way, it is not a long fiber, it's a very short fiber. This is the actual fiber which is carrying the data. So short dispersion compensating fiber, you call this as DCF. This fiber has been designed in such a way that it provides just the opposite dispersion of what has been provided by this long fiber. So if you design it in such a way that lambda 1 is traveling slower here and lambda n is traveling faster, so what it will do is it will compensate when this pulse passes through this, it will compensate that dispersion. It will again equalize them, and then again you will have a nice pulse at the output. So that is how dispersion compensation is done. Another very important technique for dispersion compensation is, it's very interesting. You have an FBG, that is fiber Bragg grating. Now, I will just tell you briefly what fiber Bragg grating does. This is a fiber Bragg grating. In the core of the fiber, there is some periodic modulation of refractive index. Now, this has a very important and very significant property, that when light is falling on this, traveling through this, there is one particular wavelength, let us say lambda 1 or lambda b, let us call this lambda b, Bragg wavelength. So that will be reflected back, and the other wavelengths, they will pass through this. So if I say I have n number of wavelengths here, lambda 1 to lambda n. So depending on this design of this grating, let's say lambda 5 here. So lambda 5 will be reflected back completely, and all lambda 1, lambda 2 up to lambda n minus lambda 5, they will be transmitted. So lambda 5 has been reflected back. So that is the principle of Bragg grating. Now, how do you use this Bragg grating in dispersion compensation? So let us see that. Now, let's see, you have a long fiber here. Okay, this is a fiber, and you have an input pulse, which is a very nice pulse without any dispersion. Now, this pulse, when it reaches at the output of this fiber, it has dispersed because of dispersion. Now you pass this through this fiber. This is again fiber arrangement, and this is a circulator. So as I mentioned earlier, that circulator has the property that anything input from here, it will go to this. Anything input from here, it will go to this, and so on. So this what this circulator does, let me see this. Yeah. Here there is a FBG in this arm of this circulator, and it is a chirped FBG. Now, what is a chirped FBG? This period of this grating was uniform here, but here it is, you can see this chirped grating, it is not a uniform grating, it is a chirped grating. So basically what a chirped grating does, it will reflect one wavelength from here, other from here, third from here, and so on. So it will be this wavelength which is reflected from here, because it finds that period of the grating here and it is reflected. Other wavelengths will pass, and they will, one of them will be reflected from here and it will come back. So now how it is actually helping in your dispersion compensation, let us see. So let us say you have a slow wavelength and fast wavelength coming from here. So let us say red one is the slowest, green is the fastest wavelength. So both of them, you pass this through this circulator, so they will go through this. Now you design your chirped FBG in such a way that this slow wavelength, which has traveled slow from over this whole fiber, it is reflected back from this point, let us say. And the green one, which is the faster wavelength, which has arrived earlier here, it is actually, because this chirping depends on the wavelength, so this fast wavelength, it is reflected from here. So now this faster wavelength has to travel a longer distance here as compared to the shorter wavelength. So when they come out from here, I mean, again, you can see that they come back at the same time if you have designed this properly. So whatever broadening of the pulse was input to this, at the output you again get a compressed or pulse without dispersion. So this I will come to the nonlinear effects, which I mentioned that you have very significant nonlinear effects in long distance communication and high bit data bit rate systems. Particularly when you have WDM, you have a lot of high power in that. So the most important is the cell phase modulation out of those. It is the very significant optical degradation effect in long transmission links. And SPM is actually caused by Kerr effect. Now, what is Kerr effect? It means that if you have a fiber, optical fiber, and a pulse is going through this, let's say a pulse is going through this fiber. Now the Kerr effect means that the refractive index here, which is, I say n, let us say 1.5 again. Let me tell you, it depends on frequency also. That is a different story now. But let us say that this Kerr effect is there, and your refractive index now, it is not constant, but it is dependent on the intensity of light. So your refractive index is intensity dependent. So now you see that if you launch a pulse having this shape, here the refractive index, here the intensity of the pulse is very high, here the intensity of the pulse is very low. Okay, if this is the pulse, the intensity is highest here, lowest at least. So when this pulse reaches or transmits through this fiber, and then if nonlinear effects, the Kerr effect comes into play, what it will mean, that it will mean that this part of the pulse sees a lower refractive index, because now the refractive index has changed with the intensity. So this part of the pulse sees a different value of refractive index, whereas the other parts, they see a different value of the refractive index. So same pulse which is going through this fiber, it is seeing different values of refractive index. So that we call as the cell phase modulation, because this phase of this pulse is modulated by itself. It itself modulates its phase, it causes phase errors. So it is because of this Kerr effect. So nonlinear effects, one is Kerr effect, which I mentioned, and the SPM is most important. XPM is also very important. Four-way mixing is another. And then you have simulated scattering, SRS, and this is Raman scattering. Maybe I will very quickly discuss these, because to finish in time. So self phase modulation, I told you that when one pulse is passing through fiber, it itself modulates itself, I mean, because the refractive index of this is changing. What is XPM? Cross phase modulation. This is very important when you talk of very high data rate systems, in which you have multiple channels, lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda n, let us say WDM, DWDM system. Now this happens, cross phase modulation means that when one wavelength is passing through this fiber, it is affecting the phase of the other one. And similarly, this wavelength is affecting the phase of this and affecting the phase of this. So here cross means this one wavelength is affecting the phase of other adjacent channel. So it is very important. Four-way mixing I will discuss in detail. So XPM, SPM, XPM and four-way mixing, you see that they all are because of the third order susceptibility, Chi 3. You pronounce it as Chi, it is Chi 3 or Chi 3. So that is there in the silica fiber. This Chi 2 is also there, but it is not present in silica fibers. It is very small. So Chi 3, third order nonlinearity is very important in this. And Kerr effect, it is very important that your refractive index is given by, as I said, the refractive index of the fiber is n. It is actually given by n is equal to, let me put here nL to be more correct. So your refractive index is nL. That is a linear part, which normally you see if you do not consider the nonlinear effects. Plus you have this factor here, that is n2. Now n2 is the nonlinear coefficient of refractive index. It is a very small value in silica fibers, extremely small. You can see it is 2.6 into 10 to the power 20 meter square per watt. But again, whenever you talk of high data rate systems and long distance optical links, this becomes significant. It may become significant, particularly in DWDM systems. So it becomes, I mean, it depends on N2 plus multiplied by the power which is carried in this. More power, you will have more of this effect. Very important thing is A effective, that is the effective mode area of the fiber. Because you know, if this is the fiber and then the pulse is propagating like this, then how much is the mode? This is the mode. So how much is the mode area, effective mode area? Because this core area is fixed. Once you design, have the fiber, then the area of the core is fixed. It depends on the radius. But the effective area is how much concentrated is your field. And if it is more concentrated, your effective area is less. So if effective area is less, then you have very high nonlinearity, very detrimental effects. So somehow the aim of the designer is to have larger effective area, A effective. You need to have a larger effective area. It means your pulse should be broad. I mean, like this. So one way is that you can have a multimode fiber. Multimode fiber will intrinsically have a large area. But again, that is a problem because you do not want to use multimode fiber because of dispersion. So again, I repeat, all these things, all these design issues, they are interdependent. It's not that you want to optimize A effective, so you want to minimize this A effective, so you want to maximize it to reduce this nonlinear effect. So once you want to maximize it, just choose any core radius. No, you cannot do that because it will disturb your other parameters. So there are these are the actually things how the nonlinearity actually affect. I have just shown two examples here. PSK, this is your PSK without any nonlinear effect. It looks like a perfect PSK, but when you have intensity dependent refractive index, that is the Kerr effect or the nonlinear effect, you see there are intensity dependent rotations. So this constellation diagram is slightly changed here. You can see the gray circles, and more dangerous is that random rotations you can have also depending on the intensity. So ultimately the eye diagram which you plot, I'm sure you know what is eye diagram. So eye diagram, the eye opening actually goes on decreasing like this because of intensity dependent rotations, and then your signal to noise ratio will decrease, bit error rate will increase. So all these things you have to take into account. Four-way mixing I will skip right now, just to tell you that when you have two channels and they are high powered, so that the nonlinearity is it comes into picture in the fiber, they will give rise to more frequencies. So I mean, let's say there are two signals here, propagating through the nonlinear fiber, and because of this four-way mixing, new frequencies are generated, this one and this one. And imagine what will happen if it is a WDM channel and there are already some frequencies or wavelengths placed here. So they will interfere with these. So that is again a very serious effect. Okay, now I will just briefly discuss what I mentioned earlier, non-zero dispersion shifted fiber. Because again, as a rule of thumb earlier, I mentioned that dispersion, if you have a zero dispersion wavelength, it is very good that you have no dispersion at that. But because of this four-way mixing, it is somewhat, sometimes it is desired to have deliberately some dispersion, some finite, maybe very small, 2 picosecond per kilometer nanometer. Normally it is 18 picosecond per kilometer per nanometer. So, and if it is a zero dispersion shifted fiber, then your dispersion will be zero. But deliberately you want to keep it a small dispersion, because if you take a zero dispersion fiber, it will actually have more four-way mixing. It will enhance four-way mixing, because in that case, different frequencies which are traveling, because there is no dispersion, so they are all traveling together, and then they interact with each other a lot. Whereas if you keep a very small amount of dispersion, these different wavelengths, they will have different speeds, and then ultimately they will have less chances of interaction and four-way mixing will be reduced. So as I said earlier, how do you mitigate the nonlinearities in high data rate systems? As I said, it depends on N2 upon A effective. N2 you cannot change once you choose the material silica, but A effective you can choose. And earlier, if you remember, I told you different profiles are there, refractive index profile. You can have a triangular profile, or you can have a depressed cladding type of profile of refractive index. So A effective can be changed by choosing your refractive index profile accordingly. Recently, several new large area of A effective, large area means A effective is large, so that your nonlinear effect is reduced, have been developed by many leading fiber manufacturers. Some examples are TerraWave. They have manufactured this Scuba 150, Scuba 125, TerraWave ultra low loss, and Vascade. These are some trade names by big companies, and you can see A effective they want to maximize here. This is quite a large effective area, so that the nonlinearity is reduced, because they are using these fibers for very high data rate systems and very high power systems. So any nonlinearity will be very crucial for that. So that is, this is Raman effect. Again, a nonlinear effect. I am not going through this, but just see that if you have WDM channel with Raman effect, this is without Raman effect, and this is the effect with Raman effect. So all channels earlier were equal in amplitude, but because of Raman, the energy of this is transferred to this, the energy of this is transferred to this. So you see that there is an uneven intensity, which is not again good for the system. Now I think I need to quickly wind it up. So this is how you do the link power design, link power budget analysis. In this case, you have a transmitter, you have a receiver, and there are various losses which are taking place. So basically what you do is you have a, let us say power, some power here, let's say 1 milliwatt, or let us say 0 dBm power, and then your receiver sensitivity, as I mentioned, let us say it is minus 32 dBm, that it can detect only this much power, not less than that. So what this power minus this power, whatever balance you get, all the losses should be covered in that. So these are the two equations, and this is the spreadsheet for calculating that budget loss which I mentioned. See, this is the output of the laser source. This is the receiver sensitivity. So if you do a subtraction, you get 30 dB of allowed loss. So all the losses, splice loss, connector loss, cable attenuation, they should be actually less than this. And you should have a final margin, which is positive. If this final margin comes out to be negative, then you say that your system design is not proper. You need to. That's why in the beginning I said you need many iterations actually to design. Maybe in one iteration you may not get good results. You have to do it again. So similarly, rise time budget analysis I will skip. This I will skip. This diagram you can see that this says how the transmission distance is varying with data rate. So you can design your parameters accordingly. In this case, you see that there are some examples taken here. This is the attenuation limit with LED and pin diode. So this is something like this. You have attenuation limit with laser and APD, which is like this, and you have the material dispersion limit. So these are actually the limits as you, this is the transmission distance is decreasing as you increase the data bit rate, say from 10 Mbps to you want to move to 20 Mbps. So earlier your attenuation limited distance was 8 kilometer. Now if you want to move to 20 Mbps higher bit rate, so your attenuation limited distance will be less than that. It will be 6 kilometer or something like that. So basically, this is the shaded area is that where you can operate. Because if you go further here, earlier this was attenuation limited, but if you go beyond 50 Mbps in this case, your link design becomes dispersion limited. Because now the dispersion becomes more dominant here at very high data bit rates. So these are the things, some things which you need to consider. And finally, I want to consider the amplifier issues. Here you have a long link and then one fiber span, and then you have inline amplifier, let us say EDFA. Then another fiber piece of, let us say 100 kilometers, again an amplifier, again 100 kilometer fiber, again an amplifier. We are actually considering these fibers. So this is how your optical power actually looks like. That initially your power is something like this. Because of attenuation, when it goes through the fiber, attenuation it drops, then you put an amplifier here, it again restores, then again there is attenuation, again there is a amplification. So maybe you can one interesting question is that how long can we go like this? Can I take it to infinite distance by this? Because whenever my power reduces, I just put an amplifier, it will again restore it. So can I go to infinite distance using 40 Gbps or 100 Gbps? The answer is no, because each amplifier, when you introduce it, slightly degrades your signal to noise ratio, degrades. Why? Because any amplifier, it will amplify the signal, it will also amplify the noise. Plus, it will add some more noise of itself. So your signal to noise ratio is going to come down after each amplification. So go to the last one slide here quickly. Yeah, this one. I have skipped some slides because I think the time is less. So you see here that if this is the total power of any cascade of amplifiers, cascade means you have n number of such amplifiers. You see there are 10, 20, 30, 40, or let us say 80 such amplifiers, and this is your power. So the total power is actually same. You can restore the total power, but actually this power is consisting of your signal and your noise. Okay, so if you sum this one and this one, you made a summation, then you get the total power. So you see how with each stage your signal power is actually decreasing, that is the actual power, your noise power is continuously increasing. So you get a feel that yes, your output power is same, but actually your signal to noise ratio is continuously decreasing along if you put more number of fibers. More number of amplifiers. So that's why it's not that you can put any number of amplifiers and you will go on and on. You have to limit the number of amplifiers. And finally, some modulation format or coding schemes are there for high data bitrate systems, because you know there are n number of such schemes are available nowadays. You can have NRZ, you can have RZ. These are the two most common line codings which on which many advanced modulation formats are based. So NRZ is something in which for one you represent one during the whole bit interval and then zero. But in RZ, this only for some part of the bit you represent a one and then it reduces to zero. So there are many variations of this NRZ inverted, Manchester, Miller, biphase, n number of such schemes are there. So basically you can have different encoding schemes also, how you modulate your electrical signal on the laser source. Your laser has a carrier, and how your electrical data, digital data is modulating it. Either you can have amplitude shift keying, something like this, where one represents a positive pulse and zero represents no signal. FSK, you can have FSK, you can have phase shift keying. So all these coding schemes are there, modulation format. And also there are many, many variations of these, as you might be knowing that you have on-off keying. On-off keying is something similar to your ASK. This is also called OOK, that is on-off keying. Then you have DPQS, differential quadrature phase shift keying, and then RZ, or you can have it using NRZ, and so many things are there. And then you see one additional advantage here in optical is that you have polarization multiplexing also. So one polarization is having this normal QPSK, another polarization, if you see the color below this, let me clear this. Yeah, this is actually going on one polarization, this is going on the perpendicular polarization. So your bit rate is actually doubled. Your spectral efficiency, actually, spectral efficiency is how many bits you have per second per hertz. So that you can increase. But the problem is that you can increase the spectral efficiency to any level. You can have 64 QAM or maybe more than that. But ultimately, this also reduces your SNR, signal to noise ratio is affected. And so you have to make a compromise that whether how much high bit rate you want and how much bit error rate you can tolerate. So again, I said it is all intermixing of these parameters. There is not one thing that you can do to optimize your system. You have to make a very logical choice of different parameters that which will work where. You have to also think about the complexity, because QAM and these are very complex. Of course, now you have DSP and digital signal processing. So that advancement has taken place. So again, it has become easier now. And that's why this coherent detection is also now again becoming very popular. Earlier, it was not so much popular because it is complex and requires very complex circuit. But with the advent of DSP, these coherent detection techniques, again, they are getting very popular. So basically, you can see that how the modulation formats and coding schemes, what is their switching capability, bits per second. So, I mean, with the year 2015 and also further, they are increasing. Like you had time division multiplexing, which had its limit. I said in the very first slide that time division multiplexing, although it is a very easy and good technique, but it has limit because of the electronics. So, and then DWDM, then you all the modulation format, DPSK, QPSK, polarization division multiplexing. So basically your speeds and capabilities are continuously increasing. So I would conclude my talk with this conclusion, which is again very important summary of what I have covered till now. So, I mean, significant advances have been made in optical technologies for high-speed fiber transmission over past few years, And it is not that they will stop. They are expected to continue to advance to meet the challenges in future optical networks. Innovations that enable high performance, more functionality, improved CapEx and OpEx. I mean, this is the initial cost, your capital expenditure, this is the operational expenditure. So basically, it's not only improving the performance, but you also need to see that you have more cost and scalability and all that. Terminal technologies, repeater technologies, and link architectural aspects. Terminal technologies means at both the terminals you have a transmitter and receiver. There are developments taking place in these technologies also. They are faster and more CMOS technologies developing. So you have more faster, I mean, transmitter and receivers nowadays. Repeater technologies that includes amplifiers. You have more and more new amplifiers. You have hybrid amplifiers, which is Raman and plus EDFA combined. Because you want to increase the bandwidth and you want a flat band gain. And link architectural aspects, that is how you do the switching, how do you do the routing. They are all actually contributing to the future high speeds. So basically, my conclusion of this talk is that all these new technologies, wherever, whether they are in the fiber, whether they are in the switching or in the component level, they all need to be examined collectively at the system level because, you know, I have told you so many things are there and they are all interconnected. So if you want to be a good designer, you need to understand the basics of each and everything, and then you need to design your system accordingly. The next era of high bit rate optical transmissions may see more advanced wireless technologies and techniques with the help of advances in high speed ICs, intelligent design of optical components, subsystems, modulation schemes, and multiplexing schemes, and so on. So with this, I would like to end this presentation. I hope you got an idea that how to design, what are the issues involved in designing a link. Depending on your requirement, on what particular application you can design, you can choose your components, you can choose the fibers, and all these things. Yeah, so thank you.
Thank you, sir, for giving us such a great and various aspects of high speed and long reach optical link designing. So now, any questions from the participants?
I think, yeah, there was a question in the chat that whether repeaters and amplifiers they can be replaced with each other. So yes, repeaters, if you use repeaters, it is a very good choice because repeater it will just regenerate your pulse. Whatever pulse you had launched initially, you can regenerate it without using of amplifiers. But the problem is that they are not transparent. You need to convert them to electrical, then you need to regenerate and then again convert to optical. So again, that puts a speed limit there. Of course, signal to noise ratio will improve, but your speed will decrease. So in very high data rate systems, regenerators are not recommended. Amplifiers, which are inline amplifiers like EDFA, they are preferred.
Good afternoon,
Yeah, any other?
sir.
Yeah, good afternoon.
You have discussed about the non-linearity part in the optical fiber. Sir, that there is some effective area that is playing an important role in reducing the non-linearity. So that, sir, that effective area is related to some mode field diameter because MFD is
Yes,
related with
actually.
the. Okay.
Yeah, it is actually related to mode field diameter.
Okay.
And effective area, I do not call it area because area of the fiber is given by that mode, that radius of core and all that. But how you confine your pulse into that is the effective area, and that is very important.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yes, so I think, yes, we have questions. Yeah, please. Any question from participant? No, so I think it's over. So yes, please ask. Basundhara, you have some question?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Hello.
Yeah, yes.
Sir, I want to ask, is there the significance of having non-linearities in our system as it leads to many causes, dispersion, inter-symbol interference? What is its significance of having a non-linearity in our system?
No, significance, you mean to say that why should we have it when it is causing problem? Is it like... Or you are talking about, so actually we are not deliberately introducing nonlinearity. It is a built-in nonlinearity in the optical fiber, silica fiber. It has some third order nonlinearity. So this effect we cannot actually completely eliminate. It will always be there. Only thing is we can minimize it. So we are not putting it deliberately nonlinearity. It is all coming from the system. And that is not desirable in most of the situations. You have some applications of nonlinearity that is there. Raman amplifiers, you can use them in Raman amplifiers. The Raman effect, because of nonlinear issues, you can use it in amplification also.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I have one more question, sir, regarding system design. As you have just gone through the rise time budget particularly the regarding the system design, actually, sir, I was facing some problem in designing one particular system. So mm-hmm. It was actually, sir, mentioned that we have to find out the maximum length without employing the repeaters for particular data rate. So okay. Without dispersion penalty, sir, we have to consider only the power budget analysis. But yeah. If there is a sir, but if it is specified only that we are not having any kind of dispersion zone, in that case we don't have to go for some rise time budget analysis.
Yeah, basically this rise time analysis is only for dispersion. I mean that limits the bandwidth because of dispersion. But I mean, unless you do both type of these analysis, your design or your analysis is not actually complete. But yeah, for initial part, you can do that power budget only if those parameters are not.
But sir, there was two cases were given that data rates are changed in both cases. In one case, it was given 25 Mbps data rate and we have to design the system with no dispersion penalty. In another case, data rate is increased to 350 Mbps. So in both cases, the length will be the same, sir, for particularly maximum length without employing repeaters, and that is the power.
If you are not considering the dispersion at all, the dispersion penalty you are not considering, yes, then it will be the same.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay, so any other question? Okay, I think there is no question. So I would like to thank you once again, sir, for such a great lecture and very informative lecture on high speed and long reach link designing. So thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.